Macmillan Audio presents The Essential Path, written and narrated for you by Neale Donald Walsch. Chapter 1. The Proposition. We're one decision away from a solution to humanity's biggest problem. This is a decision so powerful in its impact that it would solve not only our species' biggest collective problem, but the largest problem faced by every individual listening to this right now. But be warned, this decision may not be what it seems, and it definitely will not fall in line with what is most widely expected or most generally accepted. That makes it a daring decision, perhaps the most significant decision of your life. And don't think you didn't know that when you started listening to this. You knew exactly what you were doing. And why. Nobody has to tell us that life on our planet is not what we had hoped it would be. All we have to do is take a look at what's happening every day around the world, and in some cases, in our own lives. There are very few among us who have not found ourselves shaking our heads in discouraged dismay at the latest tweet or online news bulletin or newspaper headline, and sometimes, too many times perhaps, at the challenges confronted in our own home. This leads to a compelling question. Is it possible, just possible, that there's something we don't fully understand about ourselves, about life, and about God? The understanding of which would change everything. To me, the answer is obvious. Is it to you? If your answer is yes, you're invited to now undertake a very quick but deeply revealing explanation of everything. Why things are the way they are on Earth today. When our biggest problem arose. What has blocked us from the obvious solution. And how we can dissolve the problem virtually overnight. We begin with some additional compelling questions. Chapter 2. The Questions. What if the most wonderful ideas you ever had about life were true? What if the most wonderful ideas you ever had about yourself were true? What if the most wonderful ideas you ever had about God were true? What if the most wonderful ideas you ever had about what happens after you die were true? What would then be true for you? Do you think there would be any difference between how you might then experience life and how you now experience life? Your answers to these questions are now setting the course and direction of your experience on Earth. Did you know that? Not to be overly dramatic about it, but it's true. They're determining the path you will take. And humanity's collective answers to these questions are now creating the future of our species. By determining the path we will all take. Will it be the path that our species has taken for thousands of years, the one that got us here, where our lives and the world are today? Is this where we want to be? Is this our most wonderful idea about life, about ourselves, about God? Ideas are important. It's ideas that create beliefs, beliefs that create behaviors, behaviors that create experience, and experience that creates reality. And if our most wonderful ideas become our beliefs, life on our planet will look much different than it does today. Cognitive scientists tell us that all it takes is 1 in 10 people, 1 in 10 people, to emphatically embrace an idea, and the mass will follow. What then could cause just 1 in 10 people to believe that the most wonderful ideas we ever had are true? A single decision. We're one decision away. Really. But we must make that decision now. Not doing so is starting to have, on all of us, a very real effect. Chapter 3. The Effect. Let's not dance around this. We have a big problem here. On Earth, I mean. It's touching our lives every day, individually and collectively. Now, there's no reason to move into a dark and depressed state over this, because the solution really is just one decision away, And it's not even a difficult decision to make. We just have to choose to make it. Many people agree with the decision intuitively already. They simply haven't implemented it in their lives as a practical matter, probably because they're waiting to see if anyone else agrees. But the time for waiting is over. The problem now confronting us is becoming pervasive. It's evidenced not only in the world's governments and the world's corporations and the world's social or religious institutions, it's affecting all of us in individual homes all across the planet. We're feeling the effect. So what's up? What's the problem? Let's lay it out in direct terms. Humanity's biggest problem is that humanity doesn't know what humanity's biggest problem is. We can see the effect of this problem all around us, but we don't seem to see the cause. Now, you have a real problem when you know you have a problem, but don't understand what the problem is. You don't know what's causing the effect that you're observing every day. And humanity's confusion around this has gone on for so long that it's now created a condition that's threatening to become permanent. Here's one way it shows up. Perhaps more than ever in recent times, we're hearing folks say that if we do have a problem right now, it's only because of those others who are creating problems. We didn't have those problems before, these folks say, and we want to go back to the good old days. And just who exactly are those others to whom these folks are referring? It's those unwanted immigrants, those unsatisfied minorities, those unhappy women, those right-wing radicals, those left-wing nutjobs, those unacceptable gays, those uninformed students, those dumb conservatives, those empty-headed liberals, those unmotivated government assistance recipients. It's all those others who just keep making things difficult. A well-known political strategist in the United States, Brad Todd, crystallized all of this in a tweet he posted in mid-2018. I'm going to quote him here. He said, "Is the American left willing to live with and among the American right? Or are we at culture rupture?" And the phenomena is not limited to the United States, but is emerging all over the world. Newspaper columnist Paul Krugman put it this way in an opinion piece in the New York Times written at about the same time. He said, "The real crisis is an upsurge in hatred, unreasoning hatred that bears no relationship to anything the victims have done." I resonate with the urgency of Mr. Todd's questions, and I concur with Mr. Krugman's observations. Suddenly it feels as if we live in a world of us versus them. People around the globe are lining up on one side or the other, and the middle ground seems to be disappearing. Now, not everyone may feel this way, but everyone can feel everyone who feels this way, so it's affecting all of us. Each day it's producing distressing headlines, angry blogs, name-calling speeches, childish rants in tweets, bullying diatribes, finger-pointing tirades, and violence-laden outbursts. And while we may not know the underlying cause of the problem human society is now facing, the cumulative impact of that problem can be put into a single word: alienation. We're seeing it more and more. It is an outgrowth of a very contentious and unhappy situation. Chapter 4. The Situation. Alienation inevitably arises in the aftermath of ongoing citizen frustration. Citizen frustration inevitably arises in the aftermath of ongoing societal dysfunction. Societal dysfunction inevitably arises in the aftermath of ongoing systemic failure. And that's exactly what we've had here. Long-term, ongoing, systemic failure. We've put into place on our planet a wide assortment of systems created to make life better for all of us. Those systems are not working. There are some rare exceptions, but in the main, most are failing to produce the outcomes they were intended to produce. Wait. It's worse. They're actually producing the opposite. Our political systems, created to produce safety and security for the world's nations and their people, have in the main produced far too much of exactly the opposite. Ongoing disagreements, endless insulting and demonizing of opponents, dangerous trade wars, nerve-wracking military threats, and escalating violence between people at every level. Our economic systems, created to produce opportunity and sufficiency for all, have in the main produced far too much of exactly the opposite. Massive economic inequality and increasing poverty, with a handful of people, actually fewer than 10, holding more wealth and resources than 3.5 billion. That's half the planet's population. Combined. Our social systems, created to advance and facilitate the joy of living in community and build a foundation for harmony among a divergent population, have in the main produced far too much of exactly the opposite. Discordance, disparity, prejudice, and despair, with limited opportunity for upward mobility, and in far too many cases, rampant injustice, producing exasperation and outrage. Even our vaunted online internet systems, created as the newest innovation in our social systems and originally designed to bring us closer together through the marvel of social media, have in the main produced far too much of exactly the opposite. A playing of one against the other through the manipulation of emotions, a heightening of our differences, an exacerbation of our fears, and a poisoning of our minds with negativity, all of which has not brought us closer together, but driven us further apart. And saddest of all, our spiritual systems, created to inspire a greater love of God and so of each other, have in the main produced far too much of exactly the opposite. Bitter righteousness, shocking intolerance, widespread anger, deep-seated hatred, and self-justified violence. Now, you may think I've exaggerated the impact of all of this. Things are better here on Earth now than ever before, right? Well, I suppose that's true for some. But do you know that on this day, over 1.7 billion people have no access to clean water? Do you know that 1.6 billion will live without electricity? Do you know that, difficult as it may be to believe, 2.5 billion people, over a quarter of this planet's population, will not have toilets to use in this, the first quarter of the 21st century? These are more than simple inconveniences. The health hazards created by such conditions lead to thousands of unnecessary deaths each year. And speaking of unnecessary deaths, consider this statistic. More than 650 children die of starvation every hour on this planet. Every hour. Starvation? Really? While we throw away more food in restaurants from Tokyo to Paris to Los Angeles each evening than would be needed to feed the children of an entire outlying third world village for a week? Even a quick overview of such numbers, even the most dispassionate glance, surely provides dismaying evidence of our absolute, complete, and utter failure to grasp, much less activate, the simplest and most basic answers to the simplest and most basic questions that members of any sentient species would, one would think, sooner or later have to ask. Who are we? Who do we choose to be as a species? What gives here? What's going on with the human race that it cannot see itself even as it looks at itself? Where is humanity's blind spot? What is the reason for all of this? Chapter 5. The Reason. Sooner or later, every thinking person comes around to this question. Is it possible, just possible, that there's something we don't fully understand about ourselves, about life, and yes, about God, the understanding of which would change everything? It's time to ask that question everywhere. In the pews of our houses of worship, in the halls of our lawmaking bodies, in the boardrooms of our global corporations and the back rooms of our small businesses, in the town squares of our cities, in the dining rooms of our friends, and in the homes of our families. I'm going to invite you to memorize that question and ask it wherever you go. Wherever good conversation and meaningful exchange and serious problem solving is taking place, ask the question. Then, as the question hangs in the air, explain why the answer is, obviously, yes. We are a very young species. A lot of people like to think of humans as highly evolved. In fact, humanity has just emerged from its infancy on this planet. In their book, New World, New Mind, Robert Ornstein and Paul Ehrlich place this in perspective.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.